Hello, glam rockers and urban achievers and all the ships at sea, and welcome to A Very Good Year, the movie podcast where we invite a guest to pick their favorite year of movies and talk to us about that year. I'm your host, Jason Bailey, and across the mic and across the country from me is my co-host,
Michael Hull.
And our guest today is an appropriate one for Oscar Sunday, as she is the author of the fabulous book Beyond the Best Dressed, A Cultural History of the Most Glamorous, Radical, and Scandalous Oscar Fashion. She is also a very busy freelance film critic and journalist with bylines at The New York Times, The Wall Street Journal, GQ, Vanity Fair, The Atlantic, Backstage, The Hollywood Reporter, and many more. Folks, this is the charming and insightful Esther Zuckerman. Hi, Esther.
Hi, Jason. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you so much for having me in your home. We are yet again doing one of these ones where I am in the room with a guest. Mike is perpetually at least halfway across the country, but I'm here at Esther's beautiful apartment on the Upper West Side.
Yes.
So thank you for welcoming
me. Oh my God, I'm sorry. My dog is literally licking your water bottle.
Hi, Daisy. Hi.
She's licking your...
She is. So all... it's cool. I got a few drinks beforehand and I'm all set.
Okay. Would you like me to get you a glass of water?
I'm glad you enjoyed it, Daisy. Okay, let's start by plugging. Since we are debuting this episode on Oscar Day, tell those who have not read it yet about the premise and the structure of your terrific book, Beyond the Best Dressed.
Basically, it's an illustrated series of essays about Oscar fashion throughout the years. But what I really tried to do with it was less about, you know, how the outfits, not all dresses actually were made, but more about like what they say about the wearer. Mm. So the idea that the red carpet is, especially at the Oscars, is very much a statement. Like people get on it knowing that they could be photographed for your life in it, right. And what those statements are made. So it kind of covers everyone from Mary Pickford to Zendaya to Rita Moreno to Halle Berry to Cher to, of course, Bjork. It's a funny thing about, because when you think about that movie, you don't think about whimsy necessarily.
No.
The fact that you have this incredibly whimsical outfit is an interesting sort of counterpoint. And that's the sort of type of stuff that I wanted to look at, too. What films were they representing? Where were they at their personal lives? What were people saying when they took the red carpet? I write about what, for instance, like what Jane Fonda wore when she was nominated and won for Clute, which was in the height of her social activism around the Vietnam War. And actually her nomination itself was almost controversial. It wasn't controversial, but it was like, you know, people were wondering, like, are they going to punish her for speaking out? And she wore this like very stark suit, this Yves Saint Laurent suit that was like actually in her closet already, and it was very dark, and you know, it sort of said a lot without saying a lot, which is what she sort of wanted to do when she was up there. So stuff like that is sort of where I go. I think it's a really fun comprehensive look, and it's illustrated, so it has these really beautiful illustrations by Montana Forbes too, so it's a nice little keepsake type of thing as well. The dog is back to licking your water bottle.
It's okay. Totally fine. We're friends now. It makes sense. One of the difficult things about I have found about writing books about subjects that are still evolving.
Yeah.
Is that, you know, you finish the book and then other things happen.
Oh, totally.
Are there any Oscar fashion moments that have happened since you had to file the book that you wish you could like revise it to include?
You know, I think there was no one super major. I thought a lot, you know, right after it published, it was like the Kristen Stewart Spencer year where she wore like Chanel shorts, which I thought was really awesome. Mm-hmm. I do think this year will be, I think actually this year will be a year that I want to talk about, because I think over the course of the season, what Lily Gladstone has been doing with Indigenous fashion and has been really interesting. And she honestly, she said about her Oscar outfit, which I guess most listeners will probably have seen by the time that they listen to this, that it's like a museum piece and like really proving how Indigenous fashion belongs on a red carpet with everything else. So I think that is something that I would have loved to write about, obviously. But so far, there hasn't been one yet that I've been like, oh, my God, have to include.
So the book, again, is Beyond the Best Dressed, A Cultural History of the Most Glamorous, Radical, and Scandalous Oscar Fashion. And we will plug it again at the end of the show when we do those things. For us, what year did you pick to talk about and why?
I picked 1998, which sort of goes back to the book a little bit because I write about actually in the book, Gwyneth Paltrow's dress winning for Shakespeare in Love, which is this beautiful Ralph Lauren dress. And it's actually sort of the first, it's both the first Oscar dress I really remember, you know, obsessing over. And that was sort of the first, I was 8 years old at the time. And so that was sort of one of the first years I remember being sort of conscious of a movie year. You know, it's funny because most of the movies I'm going to talk about, like, I only saw one of them in theaters because I was pretty young at the time. And in some ways, they're like probably more historical years that I'm almost even more well-versed in because like there were movies that I was watching like the years where you were a kid and then like you grow up and it's just like important movies that you like never saw because like you missed them when they were in theaters, but they weren't like quite yet to be like taught in schools or your parents weren't showing them to you yet. Like it's that weird sort of thing. But yeah, I was thinking about that and it's just there's some, you know, there are movies in this year like when I'll talk about like Shakespeare in Love and like You've Got Mail, which sort of ties into the next book that I'm writing that are very, you know, like put them on at any moment type of movies. And then there are movies that in the year that I've just grown to love. And as I became like a more well-rounded cinephile, I started to really adore. So I think that's why I settled on it. Though obviously it's a hard ask, as you well know.
Yes, it is. Well, but this is one that we haven't done before. So I'm really glad that you picked it. There's, you know, as I was going through and doing prep, I was, I'm always stunned. Like there's a lot of really
great things. Yeah, and there was stuff that here. I think that I was picking for you because I was sort of like, I kept like forgetting stuff that was like in this year, and it was actually a really phenomenal year.
Great. All right. Well, we're gonna get into this top five, which is a lot of fun. Before we do, Mike is gonna kind of walk us through what was going on. It was a rather eventful year in the news, so he's gonna walk us through some of that. Here's headlines.
We're not doing any of the eventful shit.
That's fair.
I was alive in 1998. You know, I remember it was terrible. We're just keeping it weird. All right.
Sounds good.
In January 1, California banned smoking in all bars and restaurants.
And to quote Eddie Izzard's joke on that, and soon no drinking and no talking.
Yeah.
The freakout story at the time was that the restaurant industry was going to shut down if you had to go outside to have a cigarette.
I have a distinct memory of that too, honestly, because we had family friends who were devastated.
Yeah.
It's like, clearly you don't understand how much people like drinking and eating.
Yes,
I mean, correct. At least as much as smoking.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Also in January, Bill Clinton denies having sexual relations with Monica Lewinsky. That was a lie.
It turned out
that was a lie.
How did that go over?
How do you define sexual relations?
I mean, the stuff he was doing counts.
That was a lie. And the next day, Hills went on the Today Show and she did Deplorables Part 1 when she named the vast right-wing conspiracy.
I remember that. Oh, yeah, that was an early hit. Yeah.
Yep. In March, the Supreme Court ruled that federal sexual harassment laws also applied to same-sex individuals.
Okay. All right.
That's another one of those things where it's like, I guess somebody had to write that down.
I guess so. You know? I guess so.
We were growing up in 98. We were,
just,
you know.
Just
we
as slowly as we as could. Just as slowly as we fucking could. Yes.
Also in March, the Grand Wizard of the KKK in California was fined for burning a cross in his yard. You know what the fine was for?
No.
Breaking clean air regulations. God. You know what? Whatever it takes. Fuck that guy.
Whatever
it
takes.
Fuck that guy.
Whatever it takes. They put away Capone for tax evasion. They can fine the KKK dude for clean air regulation. It's fine.
In June, Microsoft released Windows 98, and I think that was also when they made the video of Bill Gates attempting to dance. Everybody's seen that video,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
Of the guys on stage, in that like pre-Trump, rich white guy fist pump dance.
Yeah.
It's hard to decide which was worse. Do we want to have a little like tip jar for which was worse, Windows 98 or Bill Gates dancing?
I think it was the latter, I'm pretty sure.
In September, a little company called Google was founded, and all their friends were just like, that name sucks, guys. That name is stupid.
We've talked about our mutual friend Lonnie Quattlebaum on the show a few times, Mike, and I have a very strong memory in about January of that year of Lonnie saying, you know, Google's going to go public later this year. We should put some money into that. And I said, what? I don't know how stocks work. And we didn't.
Plus, that's a dumb name. Nobody's going to buy
that. That's a dumb name. Who's going to want to use that? Who would ever say Google out loud? Jesus.
In October, college student Matthew Shepard was found tied to a fence in Wyoming and became a new American martyr shortly thereafter. Yeah. I don't remember that was a super productive conversation, but it was most like you kind of had to really be a fucking asshole to be like, oh, that kid, who knows what he said?
Yeah.
Right. So like it seems like in a lot of ways that was sort of
it's a real theme of this headline segment, Mike, is baby fucking steps.
Baby steps. In November, Jesse Ventura was elected governor of Minnesota because, of course, he was. And that was.
Yeah,
that
brother.
All right. Let's keep it a little bit more interesting. In February, Cambridge University in England, a researcher named Fiona Hunter, who had been studying, she studies penguins, is what Fiona did. And she, in fact, was studying specifically penguin mating habits for 5 years. And she reported that some females apparently allow male strangers to mate with them in exchange for nest building stones, thus providing what Hunter believes is the first observed animal prostitution. According to Dr. Hunter, all activity was done behind the back of the female's regular mate, right? Because we've made it, certain movies have made a big deal out of their lifetime pairings, have they not? And in a few instances after the sex act, apparently some of the male penguins gave additional stones as what she interpreted in some way as a sort of a tip.
A tip.
Although, frankly, I don't know how she worked out the, how she worked out what the situation was supposed to be.
Sure, sure. Right? What the base rate was. Sure.
So that seems a little bit to me speculative, but
okay.
We're solid on the first part. And in the most 1998 story of all time, John Crickfalusi. Do you know who that is? John Crickfalusi?
No,
I can't promise you I'm saying the name right.
I'm sure you're not.
He was
not.
The creator of TV's Ren and Stimpy.
Okay.
Okay?
All right.
Mm-hmm. In 1998, he sued the creators of South Park for ripping off a cartoon character. According to Crickfalusi, his character Nutty the Friendly Dump, an animated piece of excrement, had to have been the basis for Mr. Hanky the Christmas Poo.
Mr. Hanky the Christmas Poo.
A holiday dress singing, dancing piece of excrement, because there's no possible way in which two people could think of a singing piece of shit.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, that's 1998, really. I remember it. It was not that great. Thankfully, there were some good movies. That's headlines.
Yeah, that guy was really bad. The Ren and Stimpy guy.
Yeah. Don't Google him. If I may bring it back around to another news story. Thank you, Mike. And Esther, you ready to do a top five?
Yeah.
All right. So we decided to do a random.
Yeah, I don't have like an order. It's weird. I forget. And like, I always have to double check dates a million times. And I'm not a big like lister. I'm more of a I love everything type of gal. I hate picking favorites, I guess. So, we're going to go random. I thought I'd actually start with You've Got Mail because it's the only one of these movies that I saw in a theater.
They couldn't stand each other.
Joe Fox.
F-O-X.
F-O-X.
Look at each other.
She's a pill.
That caviar is a garnish.
Until they realized they were perfect for each other.
I don't know his name.
This woman is the most adorable creature I've ever been in contact with.
She could be a real dog.
Tom Hanks, Meg Ryan, You've Got Mail.
What are you girls talking about?
Cyber sex.
Rated PG. Starts Friday, December 18th at a theater near you.
I saw it Christmas Eve at the AMC 68, which is featured in the movie.
Of course.
And it was my family's Christmas Eve movie. And to my memory, and I have no way of proving if this is actually accurate, but they had oversold the screening. And like, can you imagine a bunch of angry Upper West Siders trying to get in to see the Nora Ephron movie on Christmas Eve.
Oh, a bloodbath.
Yeah. And I remember, like, I have this distinct memory of them opening up, like, another, like, finding a theater that, like, wasn't playing something at the time and, like, opening it up because everyone was furious. And, of course, at that time, there were, you know, no reserved seats. So right. It was just, you know, a bunch of old Jews.
The fall of Saigon in there.
A bunch of old Jews fighting with one another. But I do.
And that's pre-digital, so they're probably running like the reel from one projectionist to another.
That's
God.
As far as I remember.
I want to see this movie, Esther. You are like, this is an elevator pitch for the ages.
Yeah. So, I mean, like my personal pitch is I'm my next book is with Turner Classic Movies and Running Press, and it's called Falling in Love at the Movies, and it's sort of a fun light guide to rom-coms from screwball to today. And so obviously I've been thinking a lot about this film, thinking a lot about its you know, it's layering in with rom-com history, because obviously it's a remake of Shop Around the Corner, but it's also just for me one of those like quintessential rewatchables.
It's a cozy Sunday afternoon movie.
It's a cozy Sunday afternoon. I think the supporting performances are really fantastic. I mean, like, Parker Posey is insanely funny in this movie. Greg Kinnear is, like, a perfect... he works at the New York Observer in this movie. I guess it still exists, but RIP what it used to be.
Yeah.
And is a perfect example of that type of guy. And I think, you know, one of the things I write about the book is like the fundamental fantasy of the Meg Tom rom-coms is that like they're never in the same room together until like the very end of both of those movies, really.
Right.
And I think their sort of innate chemistry and ability to play off each other, even when they're not actually communicating, is something sort of remarkable about how that works.
How do you even do that? Holy
yeah,
shit.
And it's weird. And it's like both that and Sleepless in Seattle. Yeah. It's the same thing. And but something about like, for me, like writing about it was like something about, and I'll probably have the most like, intelligent stuff to say about this movie because I literally just like wrote about it, so I'm thinking about it a lot.
That's why we're leading with it, yes.
But like, you know, something I think about the way they portray like thinking about one another and thinking about people is really, and that goes back to sort of Nora's script, which is like the New Yorker's dream of like, you know, I mean, obviously, I'm like trying to living on the Upper West Side across the street from the Barnes & Noble that was basically like the Fox books in the movie. And now we're so grateful for this Barnes & Noble, which is so funny.
Yeah, boy, how the tides, they turn.
You know, we still do have our Strand and our Shakespeare and Company and our small, actually one down the street that is like a small used bookstore that I have no idea how it stays in business, but God bless it.
God bless it.
So that is the one that I saw in theaters, and that is the one that so I'll start with that. You know, I guess I would, for the next one, I mean, I think I'd swerve to something more that I personally found more, watched more recently in my life, but I think like sort of maybe just says a lot about my taste in like movies about New Yorkers, mm-hmm. which is The Last Days of Disco, the Whit Stillman movie.
Unemployed is not who I am. I'm a fully employed person who just happens not to have a job right now.
What if we don't marry some lawyer? What if we marry some meatball like you?
Why is it when people have sex with strangers on their mind, their IQ just drops like 40 points?
Maybe in physical terms, I'm a little cuter than you, but you should be much more popular than I am.
I live dangerously, on the edge. I'm no kindergarten teacher.
The Last Days of Disco, rated R, now playing at select theaters.
It is such a anxiety-inducing depiction of a toxic female friendship.
Oh, God.
Between Kate Beckinsale and Chloe Sevigny's character, but also that sort of, again, it's almost like it's the it captures the striving of trying to reach the sort of like Nora Ephron level life in New York of these girls working at like a publishing company trying to, you know, relive this era of the 70s that was sort of past. And I think it just has these, you know, in addition to the stressfulness of how absolutely mean Kate Beckinsale's character is to Chloe Sevigny's throughout this movie, there are these really sort of like extraordinarily romantic moments in that. I mean, like the dancing in the subway, like it's so that's that also ends up on my list. I guess like I did choose a lot of romances, which like I guess will lead me to Shakespeare in Love.
Well, the thing that I think is really interesting about Last Days of Disco is that, you know, I think it's hard for contemporary, you know, observers of the indie scene to really understand like what a big deal Whit Stillman was.
Yeah, totally. In some ways, what's funny about my relationship to Whit Stillman, which I think applies to your daughter, is that I sort of came to him through Chris Eigman. Mm-hmm. Because I watched Gilmore Girls growing up. That was like a weird, you know, connection. Like I was watching that when I freaked out
when he showed up on Gilmore Girls because, you know, I'm watching that when it's airing and it's just like, you know, that's not only
where you've been, but like, for me,
the Whit Stillman guy, but the early Baumbach guy. Yeah, I'm like, hey, welcome back, buddy. Good to see you.
But
Now he had such a singular voice and style and perspective, and just people talked in his movies in a really distinctive way.
Yeah. I mean, and I think it's beyond the sort of like WASP Woody Allen thing. I think it is like its own very distinctive thing, but I do think it is capturing this, like, it's both horrifying and aspirational at the same time. these people in his movies.
Yes, it's like well, you know, I would love to be that educated and to speak that that magnificently and have all those great clothes, but I'd be a nice person instead. Big time.
So that's, and I actually shout out to Human Boy Worldwide, who has a great Last Days of Disco hat that I wear.
Well, and it's, and also just the two, Chloe and Kate are so good together.
And Kate, I think Whit Stillman has used her like the best of anyone, even like Love and Friendship. More recently, though I guess that's like almost 10
it's it, no it's recent it's recent Esther it's fine yeah. it's recent
You know, capturing her sort of knack for being so cutting.
It's a smart movie, it's a funny movie, and also a nice little 80s New York snapshot. All right, Esther, what then is the third movie on your 1998 top five?
So I was going to pivot to Shakespeare in Love.
Everyone knows his name.
Shakespeare!
What's it called?
Romeo and Ethel, the Pirate's Daughter.
Well, that will have them rolling in the aisles.
But no one has known the real story behind the legend.
I heard you were a poet and a writer of plays that capture my heart.
Until now.
She loves me.
Time, Newsweek, and Entertainment Weekly are raving. It's the richest, most satisfying, romantic movie of the year. Ravishing and glorious. It makes movie-going fun again. Shakespeare in Love, rated R. Starts Friday, December 25th, select cities.
It obviously has the reputation of beating Saving Private Ryan.
It was the spoiler, Esther.
The spoiler, but I did see this movie shortly after it came out. My parents, I guess, were like, the nudity is fine. She loves Shakespeare. Like, she loves Shakespeare. It'll be, like, she'll deal right. with it. and watched it so much growing up. I was, you know, this is just, like, a very personal favorite in terms of, I was and still am obsessed with Tom Stoppard. And I, you know, think that screenplay is so funny and witty and smart and just sort of a magic trick in that it, like, absolutely shouldn't work, because the idea of trying to make it completely fictional, what if this is how Shakespeare wrote Romeo and Juliet's stories, should be so improbable. But the wittiness and just, you know, laugh out loud moments in that script, plus it does reach these absolutely, like, soaring emotional heights, I think. And, you know, I'm pro Gwyneth.
That's a bold stance. Yeah, anymore.
I'm pro Gwyneth, especially at this movie. and I think it's sort of, I understand, you know, and I don't know, I probably at the time would have felt pissed off by its Oscar win if I had been, you know, the more Oscar observer I am now. Mm-hmm. But I think it is such a, like, rewatchable movie, and gets at such beauty that I'm still.
Yeah. I rewatched this for the show.
Yeah.
For the first time since I saw it in the theater.
Oh, wow.
And I did see it, like, I was not 9 years old in 98, and we'll leave it there. But I saw it whenever it made it to Wichita, Kansas. I'm sure it wasn't opening weekend, but very early in the run. You know, and it is one of those movies that has been so sort of, you know, it's sort of got the dual barnacles of, oh, it stole that Oscar.
And it's Harvey Weinstein.
And it's Harvey Weinstein. And it's one of the most specific cases of his behavior.
Yes.
And bullying tactics and so forth, getting them an Oscar.
Totally.
But the movie is not responsible for either of those things. Not. The movie is fucking enchanting. Yeah, and I was struck again, and I liked it at the time.
Yeah.
But I was really struck, especially now that you cannot imagine a movie of this, you know, a movie of this type hitting culturally and commercially the way that this one did.
I mean,
I just
don't think it, like, would get made.
It wouldn't get,
like,
made, period. But if it did.
Yeah, it's so specific and it's so smart, and enchanting is a really good way of putting it. And I was just, like, a little Shakespeare freak who watched it over and over again while, like,
it's so
then
funny.
Trying to memorize, like, but it's so funny. I mean, Jeffrey Rush is so funny in it. I mean, Ben Affleck is so funny in
it. It's a great.
It was funny. I was thinking about it, like, thinking about the year. It's the year, like, it's the post Good Will Hunting year, and you have, like, Ben showing up, like, sort of shortly in this, and, like, then Damon sort of swooping in and Private Ryan, and it's sort of funny that the, you know, and it's actually, you sort of look at their careers and, like, those two, and obviously, you know, also Affleck had Armageddon, you know, which was another part of the year, but, like, it's funny, I feel like those two performances are weirdly, like, super indicative of what those two guys would eventually end up doing and being good at.
Thought that Affleck is more of a character actor than a lady.
I mean,
man.
Well, that's the thing, like, I always pointed to Affleck in Shakespeare in Love as, like, this is what he can do, like, when he's so, I mean, obviously Good Will Hunting too, he's sort of doing the same, like, he's also being a character in that.
Yeah.
But then he tried so hard to be a leading man. And then the past couple of years, like Air and The Last Duel, and like, he's like, oh yeah, I'm just going to give like great supporting performances. Yeah. And it's like, yeah, no, dude, that's like what you're really good at.
It is. Like, it 100% is. Like, and the recently departed, the great Tom Wilkinson.
Oh my God.
I forgot he was even in Fenneman. This, much less how incredible he's the money. He is in it. Oh my God.
He's so funny.
I have a hat that I've seen an apothecary
yes,
wear.
Yes, yes.
I think I could wear that.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, the way that the idea of the glamour of stage immediately softens this hardened man.
I mean,
is
I
so
think
charming.
There's few movies that capture, in addition to the romance of it, that also capture like the thrill of putting on a play.
Absolutely.
Too, in the same way. And I think that's what's so wonderful about it. It's like sort of, I literally just thought about this, but it's like sort of, it captures all like the feeling of like a high school drama production. It's like there are the people making out under the stage, and there's the, you know, there's this cool senior who's coming in who's like, you know, it, and I think that's what makes it so good. And
yeah,
so
and
wonderful.
Such a favorite of drama kids from 1998 forward, obviously.
Yeah, I hope they're still watching it, you know.
I'm sure they are.
Yeah.
If I know one thing about drama kids, it's that they are not intimidated by a pre-birth release date.
Yeah.
Esther, what is then the fourth movie on your random list of the movies of 98?
I guess I'll go for Velvet Goldmine.
I mean, if we're talking about theater kids,
yeah,
let's
exactly.
go with the glam rock
exactly.
movie next.
It doesn't really matter much what a man does with his life. What matters is the legend that grows up around him.
Brian Slade was the wildest rock star to come out of London.
The biggest thing since sliced Beatles.
But that wasn't enough.
We set out to change the world.
Yeah, again, this is more of a movie that I watched in my, as I learned about Todd Haynes and was appreciating him. I think it's just... So I think it's like just one of the most creative ways to tell a story about, I mean, I guess it's sort of the same. It's in some ways, it's the sort of same thing about Shakespeare in Love. If we're just like making the connection, which I just made right now, it's like, again, it shouldn't work. Like the Bowie non-authorized fake Bowie, fake glam rock thing sort of shouldn't work in the same way that like the fake Shakespeare thing shouldn't work. Totally. But I think what those movies have in common, weirdly, and I'm, you know, is that like there's such a love for the thing that they're portraying that it gets it right, so it doesn't feel like you're putting on, it doesn't feel like they're, you know, people in costumes or, you know, this fake version of it. It feels real because the people making it, you know, Haynes and then Stoppard in the case of Shakespeare in Love, like have such an affection for it that it like it worked, you know. And I just, you know, it's just so sexy. Like, it's just, you know, I mean, Jonathan Rhys-Meyers and Ewan and Christian Bale, who's sort of like the underrated like element of the trio, and this idea of being like a fan too.
And the contradictions of being a reporter and a fan, which I think is probably an aspect that speaks to us a bit.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it is that it's a sort of, again, magic trick of a movie. And I'm a big Todd Haynes fan.
Yeah, no, me too. The world would be such a better place if more people were following the Todd Haynes playbook for music biopics.
Yes.
Than the Taylor Hackford one, say.
Yes.
because this and I'm Not There are, I think, two of the few that are that actually work and are
and
doing
something
interesting.
And they actually capture like what's
great about the artist. Yeah.
And what's great about the artist and why we love the artist, even though they're not actually, I mean, I guess I'm Not There is a little bit more
slightly
explicit,
more authorized.
But, you know, it captures the feeling of being absorbed by the artist. So, yeah.
Now, I've seen this one a few times. I rewatched for this because I will take any excuse.
Yes.
And the thing that really struck me on this watch, and correct me if I'm wrong, there are some new songs in it.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
That to me is the most amazing thing about it. That the new songs coexist totally right next to the classic songs, like that when that they don't sound false or out of sorts with the story that they're telling, but then they can veer into, you know, the T-Rex songs or, you know, the songs that they have licensed and authorized, and it all sounds like it's from the same world. And like that in itself is like a huge accomplishment that I can't imagine trying to pull off.
And it's so intoxicating. Like it's just, it's a really, you know, the same
way. It's a vibe.
Yeah. Well, I think that's sort of, you know, you said Shakespeare in Love and Chanting. I think like this is intoxicating in a sort of different way. Yeah.
And the casual reappropriation of the Citizen Kane structure is like such a masterstroke. Yes. It's such a like, no, I'm just going to lift that.
Yeah.
Just going to borrow that for a movie. Yeah, it's a terrific movie. I still feel like this is kind of an underappreciated one in the Haynes filmography. I feel like, you know, like people who know him now from like Carol and May December maybe haven't made their way back to this one.
Yeah, well, it's not sort of part of the... I wrote a piece for the Times about like the sort of his take on like the housewife and domestic suburbia, which I think like has sort of come to define him a little bit more. I wrote specifically about like the three Julianne Moore ones, like Safe, Far From Heaven, and May December, obviously. Now, but obviously Carol fits into that, and I think, you know, his sort of his other thread, like the sort of rock and roll, you know, superstar, Velvet Goldmine.
There you go.
There, like,
those are my favorites.
Will maybe be like when he makes another one of those, we'll have a moment of Well, doesn't he like? There was this whole thing that he was going to make like a Peggy Lee thing with Let's go. Michelle
well, that's
Williams.
How you tie those together. Yeah.
Yeah. With Michelle Williams, which sounds awesome, but I don't know if that's happening anymore.
Okay. Well, that brings us to the conclusion of the top five. Perhaps the, you know, it always feels sometimes when we're running these down, I do like it when the guest saves for the last one, the one that, that people are probably waiting to see if they've included.
Yeah.
So what is the fifth?
Well, I was trying to decide, like, I don't know. I was trying to decide, and it's funny that this isn't like one of my must-haves, but I was sort of trying to decide, and I'll just say what I was trying to decide between Rushmore and Lebowski, which is what we're talking about.
Dude here.
The dude's been hired to deliver $1 million ransom.
Your life is in your hands, dude.
And now he's lost it.
You got any leads?
Leads.
Jeff Bridges.
Life goes on, man.
Ow! John Goodman.
Because the whole world gone crazy!
Julianne Moore from the creators of Fargo.
Where's the money, Lebowski?
The Big Lebowski.
It's down there somewhere. Let me take another look.
Rated R. Opens Friday at theaters everywhere.
I just chose Lebowski because it was sort of more, I mean, like, and I guess we've gone on a nice little path from, like, New York and romance to, like, rock and roll sort of like countercultural
there
figures.
We go.
So, and I think it was just more of this idea of like opening up my mind to how surreal, like to movies and the Coens, like to surreality and the Coens. And, you know, I think it's a movie that it's not my favorite Coens. Certainly, weirdly, but like but I think it has to be like,
I'm sorry, I can't, which one is
A Serious Man?
Thank you.
As my name, as my name is Esther Zuckerman. My favorite Coens is A Serious Man. I don't know. It's just like such a weirdly, it's just such a creative feat, you know? It's so unexpected at every single turn, that I think it's like, it's almost a movie. Like it's, I think it's a funny thing because, I think, you know, Lebowski has this sort of dorm room reputation now, but I think it's like such a, like, it's a weird movie to get on its wavelength too. Like you have to sort of figure out the wavelength of that movie.
100%. Yes.
And I think like, you know, it's not its current status almost like undercuts how weird that is, you know, how like how sort of difficult it makes it for you to figure out what's like even fucking going on in this movie. And yeah, so that's, and so I think the challenge of it is also why I put it on here and like wanting to add it, you know, add it to my pantheon of 1998. Though I don't know, that's so, it's, it was really hard.
Well, yeah, I mean, what I think is really interesting when you think about Lebowski in context.
Yeah.
In the terms of the context of their careers, is that like this was their follow-up to Fargo.
Yeah.
And Fargo yeah. had been, and first of all, Fargo was a big thing because like they had had this huge studio flop with Hudsucker Proxy, yeah. a movie I still love. But
yeah, great movie.
So they had done this way scaled back. It was like the lowest budget they'd done yeah. since their first movie. This, you know, and it's quirky and strange, but it is basically kind of like, you know, it's a crime movie. It's a low budget neo-noir sort of thing. And then they follow it up with this.
Yeah.
But then when you think about the arc of their career, oh, it's like, okay, well, if Fargo was them going back to Blood Simple, the movie they made after Blood Simple was Raising Arizona.
Yeah, exactly.
So of course they would follow up Fargo yeah. with like this wild, nutso, quotable comedy,
yeah.
crazy, insane thing. I again, very clear memory, opening night, going to see it with about 7 friends and just laughing for 2 hours straight.
Yeah.
It's so funny
and
so weird.
Having only seen it in the context of knowing about it beforehand,
yeah.
I can only imagine like how crazy it must have been to like, you know, sit down in that theater and be like, what the fuck, man?
That trailer was built around the Busby Berkeley bowling
sequence.
It's a really good trailer. We'll put
yeah.
it in the show notes.
Yeah.
It's like it... They
I don't think I've ever watched the
they
trailer.
They were not hiding that this was going to be a weird fucking movie.
Right.
So
right.
good for them for that
yeah.
at least. Like I know there was a pushback when it came out. There were a lot of people who were expecting another Fargo.
Yeah.
And they definitely did not yeah. get it. But it has been a pleasure to watch it become a cult movie, an honest yeah. to God cult movie, which we don't really have a lot of
yeah.
anymore.
So I mean, that was my choice, but it was a hard choice, and there is a lot of stuff that I wanted to shout out. So,
well, we'll do that. We'll do a lightning round
okay.
where we'll do some of that. Before we do,
I just want to say that 1998 was, as we've mentioned, a big year for clumsy if important steps along the road to equality and representation
sure.
in American culture and in American media. And before Big Lebowski, and maybe even I would say before like 6 to 10 years after Big Lebowski came out, a guy in a grocery store in a bathrobe and house slippers is obviously insane and potentially dangerous, definitely smells bad and should be avoided at all costs. And now when you see that same man in that
yep.
same grocery store wearing that same robe, you go, hey, it's the dude. And you
yeah.
just carry on about your day.
Representation matters.
1998.
Yeah, yeah. Feeling a little seen by the Big Lebowski, are you, Mike? Bravo.
The run on white Russians.
Yeah.
That it was like a slowly building, you know, a thing of white Russians amongst my friends where like you could slowly but surely see who had finally caught up to Lebowski over the
yeah.
next couple of years or so. And you could be in the bar with someone and they would order a white Russian and you'd be like, oh, you saw Lebowski. Did you like it? You must have.
I've still never had a white Russian.
Oh, my goodness.
It's fine
yeah.
if you like milk.
Yeah,
but
that's
a
the
lot
thing.
Of
dairy,
milk.
Dairy doesn't always sit the best.
Ah,
oh,
there
so.
We go. Well, maybe yeah,
yeah.
maybe steer clear of that.
Yeah.
All right. I will also say before we move on, one of my favorite Philip Seymour Hoffman performances.
Oh, incredible!
It's
I mean.
such a perfect like the range to go from Boogie Nights the year before to this.
Yeah. Well, and then the year after is Ripley. So
yeah,
which
that's
is,
supporting MVP is, right there.
Yeah, which
yeah.
is. You know, maybe one of my favorite. We were just watching it the other day.
So. What an actor.
Yeah.
All right. Esther, thank you so much for that smashing top five. Let's find out about the big doings of the entertainment business in the year of 1998. Here is Mike with the Hollywood Minute.
Hollywood freaks on the Hollywood scene.
As we mentioned earlier, Shakespeare in Love pulled a big upset at the Oscars, besting frontrunner Saving Private Ryan, which had won Best Director for Steven Spielberg earlier in the evening. It also ran several of the predicting prizes, including the most reliable, the Producers Guild Award. If you're curious, this year's PGA winner is Oppenheimer.
Do you think that one's gonna win best?
Oh, yeah. I mean, it'll, yeah.
There we go. So where do you, so we've touched upon it, but how do you feel about Private Ryan?
I mean, I think it's incredible. I mean, I do think it's an incredible film. Yeah. I was actually just watching it, you know, sort of in preparation for this, because I knew we would have to talk to you about it. And it is, it's undeniable. It's just hard to say, like, a personal favorite, I guess, if that's the thing.
I mean, I think that's okay that it's that it's not a Sunday afternoon cozy yeah. comfort view. I think that's fine.
It is the horrors of war in all of its yeah. in all of its brutality. And I think it's sort of, I mean, but I do think that's like sort of the, it's so weird to look back at years like this where, and like films, you know, everything from Private Ryan to Shakespeare in Love to Lebowski to things that have become like so canonized that you sort of undervalue them by the mm-hmm. time when you rewatch them and you forget how like bleak Ryan is and how weird Lebowski is and how like sort of enchanting Shakespeare in Love is because they just become like these signifiers.
Yep. Yep. That scans.
Shakespeare also won the Oscar for Best Original Screenplay, Best Actress Gwyneth Paltrow, and Best Supporting Actress Judi Dench. James Coburn won Best Supporting Actor, and Best Actor went to Roberto Benigni for Life is Beautiful.
Boy, that one held up, huh? Esther, where do you land on the old Life is Beautiful?
I mean, I have not seen it since I was a child, but I cried a lot when I was a kid.
Sure, sure. All right. That's probably the best way to leave it in your brain then.
Yeah.
All right.
Biggest commercial hit of the year was Touchstone Disney's Armageddon, which shared the same plot as the number 6 movie of the year, DreamWorks' Deep Impact, released that same summer.
Well, not the same plot.
Number 5 movie of the year was Disney's A Bug's Life, which was very similar to another animated comedy that fall, DreamWorks' Ants.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of parallel thinking in the mid-90s.
Sure,
or
sure.
Alternate theory, Jeffrey mm-hmm. Katzenberg took a bunch of ideas with him when he left Disney to start DreamWorks.
One or the other. It could go either way. Could go
honestly,
either way.
Honestly, I sort of think both Armageddon and Deep Impact sort of rule.
Okay.
That's my sort of take.
You don't have to pick sides in these things.
I don't pick a side, and the I Don't Want to Miss a Thing is an incredible karaoke song.
I will say Armageddon has one of my all-time favorite commentary tracks.
Oh, well, of course, because it has Ben Affleck being like, it was like, I asked Michael Bay, like, why wouldn't they just like teach astronauts to drill? And he's like, shut the fuck up, Ben, shut the fuck up. and it's so funny.
People do remember Ben Affleck puncturing the movie on there, but I gotta say, Billy Bob Thornton is not taking it easy on the picture either in that track. It's really entertaining.
It's very funny. And again, Don't Want to Miss a Thing, incredible karaoke
yes,
song.
Yes, a karaoke banger.
Other big box office hits of 1998 included There's Something About Mary, Mulan, Dr. Doolittle, and the number 3 movie of the year, Godzilla.
Oh, God.
Remember that guy?
God.
When I was a child, I was a really scared kid of a lot of things, from my birthday, I was taken to FAO Schwartz, but they had a Godzilla display because I'm a summer birthday, and so that was a summer movie, and it scared the shit out of me.
The display. At FAO Schwartz scared the shit out of you, to be clear. Not the movie. The movie's not that skillfully
done. And now
done,
I really like Godzilla as a concept. But I actually have never seen the role of Godzilla.
That's, you're fine.
Yeah.
You're just fine.
In 1998, we said goodbye to the great character actors E.G. Marshall and J.T. Walsh.
R.I.P.
Stand-up comic and Goodfellas co-star Henny Youngman. Lloyd Bridges, who picked the wrong week to stop sniffing airplane glue. Yep. SNL all-timer Phil Hartman, Tarzan movie co-star, and Mia Farrow's mom, Maureen O'Sullivan. The very funny Flip Wilson, legendary Screen Cowboys Gene Autry and Roy Rogers.
Wow.
West Side Story co-director Jerome Robbins, All the President's Men director Alan J. Pakula, one of the best damn filmmakers to ever do the thing, Akira Kurosawa, and the man who sings us out every week, the chairman of the board himself, old blue eyes, Frank Sinatra. And that is your Hollywood Minute.
All right. Thank you, Mike. Esther, you ready to do a lightning round?
Yes. What is the light?
Okay, here we go. I'm going to feed you a list of titles pulled from John Willis' Screen World Film Manual for 1998. You can comment briefly on each or pass if you wish. And here we go. There's Something About Mary.
Still sort of funny.
Mulan.
Great songs. Not my favorite of the Disney musicals of the time, but you know, I spent many a bus ride singing "I'll Make a Man Out of You" in my youth. So,
Clock Watchers,
amazing movie, underrated. Honestly, just watched recently. Shout out to comedian John Early, who has been stumping for this movie for a very long time. And it was hard to find. I think it's like now on Criterion or something.
It's streaming somewhere now.
Streaming somewhere now. But when I watched it, it wasn't. And it is, I mean, just all-star cast of ladies. Mm-hmm. Toni Collette, Lisa Kudrow, Parker Posey, and Alana Eubank. And a great movie about the soul-sucking world of The Office. That's not Office Space.
The Mask of Zorro.
Awesome movie. I love that movie. Catherine Zeta-Jones was the most beautiful woman I'd ever seen in my entire life. And I like was like, oh, that's femininity. Was like seeing Catherine Zeta-Jones in that movie. And so sexy. What a sexy movie. Their fight scene in the barn. Incredible.
Speaking of examples of femininity, Slums of Beverly Hills.
Awesome. I mean, I love that movie. Little Natasha.
Natasha forever.
Little Natasha. Little Krumholtz. Shout out, yeah. Krummy.
Yeah.
Yeah. What a great movie.
Babe, Pig in the City.
Deranged classic.
A Simple Plan.
Incredible Raimi.
Maybe my favorite Raimi.
My favorite Raimi, but I'm very attached to Spider-Man 2, but I'm also very attached to Drag Me to Hell. So
that was pretty great as well. Yeah, God, yeah, good filmmaker. The aforementioned Rushmore.
Great movie.
Not my favorite Wes, but an incredible Wes. It sort of falls into the Lebowski category, yeah, for me. It's not my favorite work of that filmmaker, but it is so formative in that filmmaker's filmography.
Absolutely. Darren Aronofsky's debut feature, Pi.
I've never seen it.
That's
I've actually never seen Pi.
There we go. Peter Weir's The Truman Show.
I mean, I love The Truman Show. Great movie.
Great unnominated performance.
Great unnominated performance. Ed Harris was nominated, though.
God, love Ed Harris. Okay. Gods and Monsters.
Pass.
Woolworth. I wonder how Bullworth would go over today.
Yeah, I don't think that would play very well. I don't want it.
Stepmom.
Oh, God. I think I saw Stepmom in theaters, but weirdly, why would I see Stepmom in theaters at 8 years old? But I think I did, but I have no memory of it. So other than like...
I mean, if there's one thing to take your 8-year-old child to, it's a movie where, you know, a mother dies painfully of
I saw
cancer.
A lot of weird stuff. Like, my parents would take me to like stuff that was my favorite, which was not this year, that my parents took me to was Mike Lee's Topsy Turvy. what year did that come out? I was
99.
I was 9. I was like way too young to see fucking Topsy Turvy, but there, like, so but
lovely.
Yeah, I'm gonna pass on Stepmom because I don't.
Practical Magic.
Oh, I don't love that movie as much as a lot of people do.
Neither do I.
But they look great.
They do. Yes, maybe the best Nicole Kidman's ever looked in a movie. Two from Adam Sandler in 98, The Wedding Singer and The Waterboy.
Oh, I mean...
Those are kind of your two Sandlers there.
Yeah. I mean, like, The Waterboy is not my favorite of that, like, ilk of the Sandlers. Like, I'm much more of a Happy Gilmore.
Amen.
Gal, but I love The Wedding Singer.
Wedding Singer.
And Drew
great.
Is so great in The Wedding
yes,
Singer.
Yes. Can't Hardly Wait came out in 98.
Oh, I mean, like, whatever. Pass. I don't know. It's fine. I don't have strong feelings. I mean, like, I don't have strong feelings about it.
The Object of My Affection.
Oh, is that the Paul Rudd one?
Paul Rudd and Jennifer Aniston.
I have seen that movie, but I don't have strong feelings about it, so pass.
Meet Joe Black.
Just the clip. I mean, if it all it gave us was the clip of Brad Pitt talking in patois, Diane.
That clip aside, I will go to the mat for Meet Joe Black. I am a Meet Joe Black apologist. I am a breast auteurist.
Yeah.
I'll carry on. I don't want to take up too much of your lightning round. Ever After, A Cinderella Story, speaking of Drew Barrymore.
Oh, I like Ever After. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, it's lovely.
It's lovely.
It is lovely. And Melanie Lynskey's in it.
Oh, yeah. She's so good yeah. in that movie.
Wild Things.
I don't have anything intelligent to say about Wild Things right now.
Pleasantville.
I like Pleasantville. It's sort of funny. It's so funny that and the Truman Show came up in the same year. But I think great Reese. I love when Reese is sort of being mean.
And finally, I'm going to end it with the post-Titanic Leo Twofer of The Man in the Iron Mask and Woody Allen's Celebrity.
My parents did take me to see The Man in the Iron Mask. Why? I don't know. What a strange follow-up to Titanic. Why did I think The Beach was the follow-up to Titanic? Because that was when he was made, when it hit.
Yes, these were the ones that were in the can Titanic right. yeah, was coming out. Yes.
I mean, I sort of, I guess my take on especially Man in the Iron Mask is like, I do miss sort of along the Zorro lines, I miss like those kind of movies getting made.
Swashbucklers.
Swashbucklers.
Mask of Zorro, same thing. We don't have swashbucklers anymore, yeah, Esther. Like, what the hell?
Last Duel was sort of the last one which was more complicated than that. Yes. I want just like and I love The Last Duel. I think that movie is awesome. But I want just like sort of the pure fun version of that.
Yeah. Give some British character actors a nice paycheck. Yeah. And why not? All right. Well, very good job on the lightning round. Esther, where can people follow you on social media?
On Instagram and X and Blue Sky at EZ as in my initials, writes as in I write for a living.
You sure do. You do it well, too.
Thank you.
I'm Fun City Cinema on Instagram, Jason-Bailey on Blue Sky and Letterboxd, where you can find under my list the top fives for every damn episode of the show, including this one. Mike?
I am at Brainwashed Lib on Twitter and at Fifth Column Films on Blue Sky.
And of course, if you like the show, friends, and you think, you know what? I bet some other people would like this show. I bet they'd like to give it a shot among the gigantic, overwhelming number of film podcasts out there. Please leave us a rating and or a review on your podcatcher of choice. It really does help us out. Mike, before we go, what is your favorite movie of 1998?
Man, all these movies just smell like the car that you had in 98. All these, I don't know. I can't say that like I necessarily saw them all with you.
Yeah.
But like, you know, I was in. We were both in town. We were doing a lot of stuff. Like, as I was scrolling this list, so many of these movies I saw with you.
Yeah.
I can't say Happiness is my favorite movie of 1998, but like it's definitely the most interesting movie that came out in 1998.
Sure.
But I think the movie that I remember the best and that I've probably seen the most is American History X.
Oh, wow. Okay.
I spent all of the 90s, like, literally actually fighting them dudes.
Yeah.
Like, sometimes with my fists, mm-hmm. sometimes, unfortunately, with my face,
mm-hmm.
You know, sometimes, like, with flyers, sometimes. But, I mean, that movie just felt, you know, the sort of the Nazi punk thing was a really big deal in the 90s. It sort of hit its apex in the 90s. And we just kind of, you know, I didn't know that there was like a nationally organized thing happening and that like there were people in Minnesota,
mm-hmm.
you know, the Baldies were forming to fight the Nazis. And, you know, I didn't know that this was something that was happening all over the country. I just knew that like I was going to these shows and then these fucking bald dudes started showing up and like talking this Nazi shit. And I didn't really know anything about that either. I just knew that like my family fought Nazis.
Mm-hmm.
They went to other countries and they fought Nazis. Like, that was all I knew. So whenever that shit came up in my family or in my house or in anybody I was around, it was always a bad thing.
Yeah.
It was sort of a given. You know, I didn't really know a lot of the details of what they believed. And then these dudes started showing up to the shows that I was at and like literally Sieg Heiling. And I was like, what the fuck? Fuck that. And started fighting these guys. And I just like, it was so intense and it felt like it was really only sort of happening to like me and my friends.
Mm.
And then all of a sudden there was this movie.
Yeah.
You know, and like that movie didn't happen in Wichita, Kansas, but it was all the same assholes and it was all the same bullshit.
Yeah.
You know, like, it just felt really real. And as I sort of got older and grew out of that, sort of like life and universe and learned a lot more about movies, I watched it again and I was like, oh, like this is actually a really good movie. This is extremely well crafted. It looks great. It's fucking, it's super creative. But to me, it was, it felt like not a documentary. Like that sounds kind of silly to say, but like it just felt too real.
It's
and
authentic.
Too personal.
It's really authentic. Yeah.
To like watch it as a movie.
Yeah.
For a long time.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, because that movie smelled like a bar.
Yeah.
That movie didn't smell like your car, but it smelled like clubs that we used to go to and shows that we used to go to and all that kind of stuff. And it just like, and I watch it now and it has the same sort of power over me that it did then.
Yeah.
And, you know, basketball just didn't have that effect. So anyway, yeah. I love that movie. I can't recommend anybody watch it because it's a fucking shit show and it's about a lot of bad feelings and a lot of bad times and a lot of bad people. But for me, it's the one that still hangs on the hardest. How about you?
Mike, in 1998, a gentleman named Steven Soderbergh mounted one of the maybe greatest comebacks in cinema history with a little picture called
Out
of Sight.
You've been waiting your entire career to get to do this particular recommendation. I'm really sorry I interrupted it. I just wanted to recognize it.
I love Out of Sight so much.
I love it too.
You know, and it really was. Like he started the 90s indie movement with Sex, Lies, and Videotape. Like it's hard to overstate how huge that movie's impact was. But if you'd like to hear that, then go listen to our 89 with John Pearson episode. And then like went and like farted around making the weirdest little experimental movies that he wanted to make for the next several years. And could have just kind of disappeared and been a one-hit wonder. And instead, God bless Universal Pictures, which is not the kind of thing we say often on this show, but an exec at Universal named Casey Silver said, took him this script, the Scott Frank adaptation of this Elmore Leonard novel, and said, I think you could maybe do something really interesting with this. And Soderbergh initially turned him down because he didn't want to sell out to the man. And then thankfully he reconsidered and started one of the best runs in contemporary cinema, made George Clooney a movie star, made Jennifer Lopez more of a movie star, launched a ton of great supporting players. It is as much fun as any great movie of 1998. Yeah. It is so pleasurable to watch. It is drunk off the act of making a movie, and you can feel the exhilaration of a real artist getting one last shot. It's almost like a heist movie in that way. It's like one last job that ended up turning into the second act of a really incredible career. I love Out of Sight so much.
It's kind of slick and perfect in the way that like, you know, he's the only person that could have made the Ocean's movies as good as they are.
Right.
Yeah.
And at least in my mind, that was the first time we saw him
in that mode,
sort of show that side of himself.
And he understands movie stars so well.
Yes, he does. Yes.
Yeah. He just like understands movie star charisma in such like a profound way, like that's here and then like in the Ocean's movies.
Yeah, no, that is like the hottest sex scene where people don't fuck.
Oh yeah.
But the brilliant intercutting, Ann V. Coates is the editor on that. And she was like, this is at the end of a storied career. The cutting in that sequence is incredible. They are great together. And I also think what's great about Soderbergh, and then I swear to God, I'll stop talking about this movie. I've written pieces about it. Is that he's also, what's great about Soderbergh is he will admit when he's wrong and when something doesn't work, and he will fix it. Cause you can get that Blu-ray, and in the deleted scenes, there's like a one shot version of the trunk scene. He was like, oh, this is great. I'll do it all in one. And you'll just watch them fall in love in real time. And it doesn't work at all. And he watched the movie and he said, that doesn't work at all. My great cool idea fucking failed. Let's go shoot it the right way. And then he did. And like that, I think, is a big part of why he's Steven Soderbergh, is that he has good ideas that he also will not go down with the ship on. Okay.
I didn't know that about Ann Coates. That's cool. That's like finding out the Rio Bravo lady wrote Empire Strikes Back.
Yeah,
like,
that's a really good analogy. All right. Thank you again, Esther.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Oh, and the book. Oh, no. We got to plug one more time. The book that's out now is
Beyond the Best Dressed, The Cultural History of the Most Glamorous, Radical, and Scandalous Oscar Fashion. And the one that's coming out, it'll be out in December. So you know, sometime from now. But it's called Falling in Love in the Movies, rom-coms from the screwball era to today. And it is from Turner Classic Movies.
Read those books and just go read Esther's stuff because it's really good.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you, Jason.
And thank you for listening.
It was a very good year.